Okay, so now we are on the chapter 7 of Bhagavad Gita, and so in this chapter, Krishna is talking about the nature of reality, like what are the different elements in the nature, and what he is and what he is not in them, right? He tried to give a very nice picture of how to, like, which state he's talking from, and what are the other elements in the nature, right? So, the first interesting verse is earth, water, fire, air, ether, space, mind, intellect, and ego. This is my material nature and divided into 8 parts, right? So he is giving the elements of the nature. This is how a nature is made, right? These are the 8 elements through which the nature is made, right? Earth, water, fire, air, and space. These are like 5 main elements. And then mind, intellect, and ego. These are 3 subtle elements. And through these, everything is made out of. Humans, animals, rock, tree, whatever it is made out of these 8 elements, right? So he's giving it like these are the basic elements through which different permutation combinations and different different things are coming out. But fundamentally, they are these 8 elements only. And the interesting thing is, he's just talking about these elements like an element. That's all, right? So earth is earth. He's not talking about the body. He's not talking about, you know, water inside my body and water outside my body. So that way I am this. And so he's just talking about these things like pure elements, right? There's nothing I in these things, right? The earth is earth and water is water and fire is fire, right? And when they come together this way, then it becomes like that object, something like this, yeah? And even more interesting is he's talking about the mind, intellect, and ego. Again, just like subtle object, that's all, right? Mind is just mind, just like earth is an earth, stone is a stone. Stone and body in some ways kind of the same, because from the material standpoint, they are the kind of same, right? They are made out of the same material, right? In the same way, he's saying the mind is just mind in a way, right? The mind is a subtle element and that's all it is, right? Intellect is also another subtle element. And even the ego, right? It feels like... And again, the ego doesn't mean like some selfish person kind of thing. Ego means identity, right? This individualness, that kind of ego. He's talking about egoism also like an element. It's just another element in the nature. That's all, right? Just like a tree, just like, you know, just like a water or just like fire. It's another element. That's all, right? And mix these things and you get a different element in the nature. A different object in the nature. So such is my inferior nature, but know it is different from my higher nature, Arjuna, by which this universe is sustained, right? The word he is using here is dharyate jagat. I mean, it's more like a base. So he's saying other than these 8 elements, right, which you are always seeing basically, which is basically form, right, which all of these has a form, even the subtle form, but the form is there. But on the other hand, there's another element here, right? And by that element, and which is like a base on which all these elements are coming, right? And in the next verse, he's also talking about, understand this, I am the origin, also the dissolution of the entire universe, right? So he's basically saying, I am like, there's this another element he's talking about, which he's saying, I am. From that element point of view, that element is kind of the source of all the other elements. That element is like a base on which everything else is standing, right? So he's talking about that element as, you know, it is also a source as well as dissolution, right? So everything is coming from that element and dissolving in that element. And that element is higher nature as compared to these different things that we are seeing, right? So we are not seeing it. It doesn't have a form. But it's another, but it is nonetheless present, right? And we are not able to see it, so we don't know about it. But he is pointing out in that direction here, right? So nothing higher than me exists, O Arjuna. He is talking like he's talking from the standpoint of that element, right? He's talking that is I am, right? That base element on which everything is standing, or that substratum is what I am. And he's saying nothing higher than me exists, Arjuna. On me, all this universe is strung like a pulse on a thread, right? So he's saying everything is permeated by me, right? Basically, they are like in me. Again, a good example here is like a water and the wave. It's like the fundamental substratum is basically water, and every wave or everything else is actually made out of the water, right? So in the same way, he's saying, nothing higher than me exists, Arjuna. On me, all this universe is strung like a pulse on a thread, right? And then he gives some very interesting examples of like trying to point out to you, you know, it's like to see either I am formless, but see like how I come forward kind of thing, you know. So you say, I am the liquidity of water, Arjuna. I am the radiance in the sun. I am the sacred syllable in the Vedas, sound in the air, manhood in the man, right? So let's take one out of them. I am the radiance in the sun, right? So that's what he's trying to point out. I am fundamentally the essence, right? If you take the radiance out of sun, if you take the fire out of sun, there is no sun, basically, right? So he's saying, I am the radiance itself in the sun, right? The same way he's keep going on with these different examples. Brilliance in the fire, life in all being, austerity and aesthetic. So he's saying, I am like, you know, again, life. I am the life of everything, right? Fundamentally, what you are seeing me, fundamentally, what you are seeing is me through a different aspects, right? The energy itself, like the life itself is what he's saying I am. Then I am the intelligence of intelligent. I am the splendor of a splendid. I am the mighty of a might. I am the might of the mighty. And this way he's trying to explain, trying to point out to, you know, you cannot see me, but you need to understand, like, I am basically behind everything, right? I am what you are saying. And it is formless though, yeah? Very interesting. And then he talks about the gunas. He also talked about the gunas before. Like basically everything in the nature is made out of these three gunas. So he says these different elements also are going to be made out of different gunas or classified in different gunas. So again, he's talking about the sattvic, tamasic, rajasic. Sattvic means more balance, tamasic more inertia, rajasic more agitation. And then he says, you know, everything is made out of or can be classified in these three gunas, but know that they are proceed from me, but I am not them. They are in me. So he's saying, I am even behind them, right? I am not really affected by them, but they are actually originated from me itself, right? And they cannot touch me, kind of way, you know? All the universe is deluded by these three states of being, composed of the quality. It does not recognize me who is higher than these, right? So it's like everybody get entangled in these three different, the qualities, three different gunas. Because of them, they cannot really see me. They cannot really realize me that there's something behind them which is acting. You know, maybe not the acting, but which is something behind them, which is kind of the source of it all. You know, then he talks like this illusion of mind made up of three qualities is difficult to penetrate. But when somebody resort to me, he can transcend this illusion. Right? He talks about it as an illusion. And he goes on in the terms of like people are not seeing me, but they are, you know, getting stuck on all these different elements. And that's why, and that's in some way that's what is called more like a self-realization also, right? Somebody who can, you know, go beyond these three gunas and can actually realize I am not them, but like, you know, is more something which is behind them kind of thing. So because of the arising of desire and hatred, because of the deluding power of a pair of opposite, like pain and pleasure, all being fall into the delusion at the birth itself, right? So he's saying as soon as somebody born, he get into this delusion of because of this desire, hatred, liking, not liking, and the different pair of opposite. And once we have done this, right, once we have like I like this, I don't like this, I want this, I don't want it, then our minds are automatically very active. And when our minds are also very active, then we do not see anything other than our mind itself, right? So that way he you know get lost. We get the we lose this perspective of what exactly is this substance he's talking about. But those in whom evil has come to an end, and those men whose actions are pure, they liberated from the deluding power of opposite and worship me with the firm vow. So eventually, when somebody has purified his actions and no more directed from this desire, hatred, and fear of opposites, that person again come back to the natural state, and that person can realize me, right? This substance he's talking about, the source of it all. And once he realizes it, then he's worship me with the firm determination, right? Yep, so that is the chapter 7.